book, Little People, Learning to See the World Through My Daughter's Eyes, which he was in 2003. He's a professor at Northeastern University of Journalism, and he's also a weekly panelist on the public affairs program, Beat the Press, which is on WGBH-TV. So he's going to be your speaker today, but first we're going to do a little 10-minute video.
Now this has to do with small people?
Yeah, and with little people, as they sometimes call themselves.
None of your family are small, are they?
No, they're not. It's just one of those things where one gene, you know, just trips.
Oh, where's that?
Yeah.
I never asked you before, but, you know, I've always been interested in to know why.
Yeah.
It's a new experience to me.
Mm-hmm. Well, I gotta tell you, it is for me as well.
Yeah, really? Well, you went back to Boston, you know, your family?
Yep.
You're listening to the Saturday Morning Greenhouse on the Talk of the Bay, AM 1340 WNBH, New Bedford.
Tonight you were going to come with the boxing matches.
Yeah?
Yeah, really, there was a boxing match at Patrick Field.
Did he know I was coming?
Oh, you kidding? You already had a ride.
Oh, and he went anyway?
Yes. Yeah. That was
okay. Yeah, that was me.
Jimmy Connors was fighting in the Sergeant Field the day you were born. He was fighting a guy with an Irish name, but he was really a Greek from Lowell or Lynn. Your father came up the aisle and said, "It's a boy," and I said, "Oh, good, because I just had a boy myself in March."
When did somebody notice that something was up?
That night, Dr. Collins, the pediatrician, came in, and they didn't really know what the situation was.
What were the indicators?
You were not as long as the average child. They had suspected something.
Do you remember when I was born?
I remember. And there were a lot of fears. I don't think anybody really knew what it meant at first, what exactly was going to happen, and what kind of issues you would have.
Were they getting good information?
I don't think so. I don't think back then they had a lot of information. I don't think that they really knew what it meant.
Your mother was your typical mother female reaction, which was not easy, you know, to cope with. She had a difficult time. But your father, because he was there and his attitude, I think, had a big influence and a big help on keeping her on a stable path.
Well, it was upsetting, but we had to cope with it and eventually come to terms with it.
I knew that there was a lot of concern. I started taking you to people up in Boston.
We just back and forth to Boston. And Dr. Griffin, remember Dr. Griffin? Wonderful, wonderful man.
Yeah, he's
a wonderful man. He was the one who did your first operation.
Yeah.
And on your hips, remember your hips?
Because I have
a reason. So they wired you all together. They go get all the bones. They wired you up again.
Yeah.
And you're in that body cast.
Yeah.
For 7 months. And where we put you, where your dad put you, that's where you stayed for the day.
Did you ever meet any other families with?
No.
No.
They did have some at the hospital, but we never. Many people were standoffish and didn't like to discuss anything.
Anything that annoyed you over the course of
time? Several times.
Such as?
Well, he's already left you his cousin.
What was he doing? Taunting
you. And I remember Dad telling me if he said, "Does anything more to you, pick up the crutch and hit it." But that was good because he never did it again. I do remember one tough day that you had when you were in parochial school. And the kids were picking on you in the parking lot, and your mom came home after dropping you off, and she was upset. You never felt sorry for yourself. And I saw no sadness in you. Maybe twice growing up, I saw you sitting with your dog on the top step after a hard day, and thought I was the only one who knew if you were sad, you know? Dad encouraged you to try anything that you wanted to do. And if you couldn't do it, you couldn't do it, but you were exposed to lots of things. You went to all kinds of ball games, hockey. I remember playing hockey. Remember you were the goalie?
Yes.
And when you had eye trouble, they stopped you from doing that. They had stopped you from riding a bicycle.
I remember bursting into tears when they told me that.
Yes.
The goals were all set up by the medical people. You had limits, and he wanted you to, whatever that limit was, to do it, and maybe a little more. And what you did.
That's right, I agree.
And sometimes a little more than that.
He's awesome, I agree. I bet you have incredible memories.
Yeah, I do. The one I like to tell people, this thing that my dad and Mr. Brito built, which was effectively an old baby carriage with a piece of plywood on top. So they plop me down on that and push me around the boulevard. And that's the best thing that they ever did for me. It was sort of like, you know, here we are. You know, on the cold winter days, you know, at any time, just to get me out. I truly never met another person like me until I was, let's say, 35. So that's meaningful, it really is. I pretended not to notice people pretending not to notice me. And I pretended not to care what they did. I avoided mirrors and having my picture taken, or defining myself as any one thing or another. Until now. Now it's become necessary to seek out people who are more comfortable on camera, and with whom I might share a little common ground.
When I was 6 years old, this kid that was in my kindergarten class, who continued to harass me up to the point where I graduated, punched me in the stomach and said, "You're a midget and you're never going to be any taller than you are right now," which of course was not true. So I went home and I said to my parents, "What's a midget?"
I think any parent of a little person is special in some way, you know, even if they don't want to be. You know, just the tough love, the lack of, you know, pampering, the not being overprotective. I believe when I learned how to swim, I had a body cast on at the time. My dad would go get, you know, the big glad trash bag and duct tape it around my waist and throw me in the pool, you know. And, you know, with me kicking and screaming, "Dad, don't do it," you know, and the whole time.
Well, thank you so much for coming out early on a Saturday morning. One of the things that's interesting about this documentary, I know Steve Delano, and I was in touch with him while he was making that. I actually appear in it for a minute or two before the end. I know that you're all interested in disability. That's why you're in this program. Steve has a type of dwarfism known as SED, and if I can do this early in the morning, it stands for spondyloepiphyseal dysplasia. I think I got through it. It is a more, you notice all of the medical problems he went through when he was younger, and he continues to have a slightly difficult time getting around. It is a more disabling condition than what I'm mainly going to be talking about this morning. Which is because the vast majority of people with dwarfism are less disabled than Steve is or than Matt Roloff. By the way, I was out here talking about this same subject about 3 years ago, I think. And at the time, my book had just come out. It's now out of print, unfortunately, although I think you can find a used copy on Amazon. And I probably gave a more personal talk 3 years ago than I'm going to today. I just thought it might be more interesting to get into some of the issues surrounding dwarfism this morning. I frankly have done the personal thing until I'm sick of it. And if I'm sick of it, you probably aren't going to want to listen to me all that much. So I'd like to begin by exploring whether dwarfism can even be considered a disability, which is something of a controversial topic within the dwarf community. Dwarfism, oddly enough, is hot right now. I mean, who would have ever thought it? But probably the main example of that is Little People, Big World on TLC. How many of you have ever seen that show? Okay, well, great. So a lot of you are familiar with the Roloff family, who I know a bit, and very nice people. You notice that Matt needs crutches and a scooter to get around because of his particular type of dwarfism. Zach, at one point, goes through a pretty scary medical emergency that's dwarfism-related. And I don't want to downplay that. But you can also see from watching the show that that's the exception. For the most part, Matt, Amy, and Zach, and Matt and Amy's two average size kids, is it two or three?
Three.
Three, okay, I'm sorry, I haven't watched it for a while, go about their lives just like anyone else. Now, let me turn the subject a little bit to some of the research I did when I was doing my book, because it was a real eye-opener to me. And I think I ended up kind of exploding a myth that people within the community had been living with for many decades. My intention had been to get into, as part of my historical research, to get into the Nazi elimination of people with dwarfism. This was taken as gospel within the dwarf community. Hitler killed all the dwarfs. So I said, you know, this sounds like an absolute must area to explore. And in fact, in my original proposal, I suggested that I would do some research in Auschwitz and some of the other parts of Germany. My publisher never came through with that kind of advance, so I said, that isn't going to happen. But I was able to do my research over here. And what I found was that you may or may not be aware that the Nazis did conduct a terrible campaign against people with dwarfism in the 30s. In some ways, it was kind of a dress rehearsal for the Holocaust, but that people with dwarfism were not really part of that. People with mental disabilities, people with severe physical disabilities, some of whom might have had dwarfism, were all eliminated. In some cases, in gas chambers and ovens, machinery that was later turned over for use in the campaign against the Jews. But people with dwarfism largely escaped this. There's no record of it happening. And here's something that people took as gospel. People would tell me about it, and I found that there was just no basis in fact for it. What I did find was that there were dwarfs who were caught up in the Holocaust because they were Jews. And in some cases, they were subjected to terrible medical experiments because they were dwarfs. But they wouldn't have gotten caught up in this in the first place if they weren't also Jewish. There's a story of a very famous family of Hungarian entertainers, the Opitz family. There were, seven or eight of them, I think. And one of them lived long enough to take part in a fascinating documentary made in Israel a few years ago. And they talk about traveling throughout Europe and entertaining all during World War II. And German soldiers, you know, helping them up onto the train so that they could get onto the next show. And then at some point, it's discovered that they're Jewish. They're sent to Auschwitz. They're caught up in Joseph Mengele's experiments. Miraculously enough, all of them survived. But you see that the dwarfism itself was not seen in the same light as other disabilities. Their crime, if you will, was not being disabled, it was being Jewish. The whole question of whether dwarfism is a disability or merely a difference, akin to race or sexual orientation, is something that I explore quite a bit in Little People. And in the end, I concluded that it was both. it's a difference in the mere short stature and unusual appearance isn't disabling at all. It's a difference, and one that many people in the dwarf community are quite proud of. It's a disability in the sense that dwarfism can lead to real physical disability. There is a whole host of potential medical problems associated with different types of dwarfism. Now, since all of you seem to be fans of Little People, Big World, I can use the Roloff family to kind of illustrate this point. Matt is physically disabled in a way that Amy isn't. You can see that. They have different types of dwarfism. 4 years ago, I heard Amy tell an audience that she had never suffered a single physical problem as a result of her dwarfism. She'd escaped any medical issues whatsoever, and today she's in her 40s and doing very well, as you can see. Finally, it's a social disability, even when it isn't a physical disability. The human-made environment is built for people who are between 5 and 6 feet tall. A generation or two ago, there was resistance within the dwarf community, even to the word disability. People didn't like to use that word. They liked to think of themselves as not being disabled at all. What people learned, especially the more politically aware people who were in charge of running Little People of America, is that, in fact, they needed to make common cause with other disability rights groups to fight for things that they needed, such as handicap placards for people with dwarfism so that they're not trying to walk 2 miles across a parking lot at night, which is not only physically uncomfortable, but could be dangerous as well. To fight for lower ATMs, to fight for lower gas station pumps. One interesting thing about ATMs is that I may be a little bit off on my relative heights here, but the standard setting group, it's a private group that drafts model laws that sometimes get adopted by the state and federal governments. They were moving toward a height of 48 inches, I think, for ATMs, because that is the height at which someone who uses a wheelchair would be able to reach up and use the ATM. And people in Little People of America realized we didn't take part in this conversation, and we should have. They got together at an LPA conference 1 year and sort of, okay, what we're going to do is everybody just line up. We're going to see what the height is for people with dwarfism to use an ATM. And it turned out to be 42 inches. That was the average that was needed. Now, for some people, 42 inches wouldn't even be good enough. But on average, 42 inches was the right height for the vast majority of people with dwarfism. 6 inches lower than what was needed for people in a wheelchair. So this process of advocacy began, and I believe that the model statute now says 42 inches. And that was as a result of people with dwarfism finally being willing to say, okay, this is a disability. There are things that we need in order to be full participants in society, and so that they were pretty successful in doing that. Now, today, it's never been easier to be different, and the way that dwarfism is portrayed in popular culture has never been more positive than it is today, even though there continues to be negative portrayals as well. Yet, we are also on the verge of medical breakthroughs that would allow us to eliminate dwarfism and many other types of genetic diversity. So that's kind of a major theme of Little People as well. Now, having sort of jumped ahead to a topic that was on my mind, I thought I would kind of go back to the beginning and also run through some talking points that Dr. Huber suggested to me. As a way of sort of covering the whole topic. I'm afraid I might have over-prepared, and If I see that we're running out of time for questions, I'll just stop. And certainly you can ask a question at any point while I'm talking, because I think what's on your mind is the most important thing here this morning, and I don't know what's on your mind. So let me just start off very simply with what is dwarfism. Little People of America defines dwarfism, or at least defines eligibility for membership, as any medical or genetic condition that results in an adult height of 4'10" or less, usually, and it applies equally to men and women. The reason I say usually is that when Matt Roloff was the president of LPA, he and I actually rewrote the guidelines a little bit to take into account the fact that some people with dwarfism conditions are a little taller than 4'10". And we didn't want to exclude people merely on that basis. Now, this is a very expansive definition. There is a past president of LPA who is 4'8" as a result of childhood Crohn's disease, which is not what we would generally think of when we think about dwarfism. And yet, he's been a huge contributor to LPA over the years, and in fact, he fits the LPA definition of dwarfism. He had a medical condition, and he's under 4'10". Now, LPA obviously has no monopoly on the right to define what dwarfism is. I've seen medical definitions that are different from that, and that do a better job, frankly, of taking into account the natural differences in height between men and women. There are some that say, you know, dwarfism, men this height, women this height. Or I should say, men this height, women this height. There are about 200 identified forms of dwarfism. But by far, what most people think about when they think about dwarfism is achondroplasia, which accounts for maybe 70% or 80% of all dwarfism diagnoses. This is what you might call the classic dwarf look, about 4 feet tall, remarkably little variation from that. I think that something like 95% of all people with achondroplasia are between 3'10" and 4'2". Slightly enlarged head, short arms and legs, and largely because of the way their back is put together and because their legs are so short, there's kind of this classic swaying movement when they walk. This is what our daughter, Becky, has. This is what Amy and Zach Roloff have, achondroplasia. But not Matt. Matt has a more medically complex type of dwarfism called diastrophic dysplasia. Though interestingly enough, achondroplasia has some effect on the bones of the face, so that you can see that Amy and Zach have a certain appearance to them that very much says, I'm a dwarf. Diastrophic dysplasia, even though it's much more complex medically, has no effect on the face. And if you simply took a picture of Matt's face, you wouldn't know whether he was 3'10" or 5'10". People with achondroplasia, and for that matter most other types of dwarfism, have normal intelligence, normal lifespans, and generally good health, although there are some potentially serious issues, especially in babies and people who are middle-aged and older. It's a dominant condition, and you all do Mendel and the Ps at some point, I'm sure. There's no such thing as somebody who's a carrier of achondroplasia. You either have it or you don't. It's a one gene condition, not a two gene condition. Now, if people with achondroplasia, if a couple has children, there is a 25% chance, of course, that their child will be not affected. And sort of the politically correct term that we use for somebody who does not have dwarfism is someone of average height. And there's a 50% chance of inheriting one gene, and that kid would be a normal dwarf. And a 25% chance of inheriting two genes. And that is that's called a double dominant condition, and it's fatal. There has been a genetic test for achondroplasia since the early 90s, and it is often recommended for couples where both parents have achondroplasia, because if they inherit the double dominant, if their baby inherits the double dominant condition, well, frankly, they might want to consider terminating the pregnancy, because it's going to come to a pretty tragic end if they don't. The frequency is achondroplasia arises in one in every 25,000 to 40,000 births. That's a kind of a wide range. There is some sense, nearly all of these births are the result of random mutations in average size couples, something like 80%. Although increasingly, couples with dwarfism are having kids too. There is some sense that achondroplasia has become somewhat more frequent as we have children later in life. I think people tend to have kids a little later today than maybe in the classic sense, and that may account for it moving more away from the one in every 40,000 and more toward the one in every 25,000. Yes?
You're saying how couples with dwarfism, is their baby going to be a dwarf no matter what?
No. Well, first of all, let's just restrict this to achondroplasia, because it gets into the genetics of a dominant condition. There's a 25% chance, since each partner has a gene for achondroplasia and a gene that would not produce achondroplasia, there's a 25% chance that their children will not be dwarfs, and they won't have either gene for achondroplasia, so they are no more likely to pass along achondroplasia than anyone else. And again, as we were talking, the Roloffs have three kids who are average size. Now, Amy has achondroplasia, which is a dominant condition. Matt has diastrophic dysplasia, which is a recessive condition. So Matt would be very unlikely to pass along his dwarfism in any case. So they have a 50% chance of having kids who are not dwarfs on every occasion. And in fact, they have one kid with achondroplasia and three who are average size. Yes?
Are there complications with the pregnancies of women who are dwarfs having average size, average height people?
The only real complication is that invariably you need a C-section. I don't mean if an average-sized mother is going to have a child with dwarfism. I mean if a dwarf mother is going to have a child. You know, there are issues in the size of the hips and all of that. So invariably, a C-section is needed. But other than that, it's not a big deal. Not a big deal at all. Other common types of dwarfism are diastrophic dysplasia, Matt Roloff, SED, Steve Delano, and there's a whole list that's very long of lesser conditions. There was a brief flash of Meredith Eaton, who's an actress, up on the screen. She has pseudo-achondroplasia, and it is to her never-ending horror that she has exactly the same type of dwarfism, and therefore somewhat resembles another dwarf actress in show business, the former porn star Bridget the Midget. Meredith told me that people will sometimes stop her on the street and say, "You're Bridget the Midget," and she's just horrified because of what this other woman has done with her career. Now, those are all disproportionate types of dwarfism. Which is by far the most common. And by disproportionate, I simply mean that people's arms and legs are not in the same proportion to their to the rest of their body as it would be in an average-sized person. There's also something known as proportionate dwarfism, which is generally caused by a lack of natural human growth hormone. And this has always been a more rare condition. These days, it's almost unheard of because the kids start getting injections of synthetic human growth hormone at a fairly young age, and they end up being pretty much the same size as their peers. Until recently, people with proportionate forms of dwarfism were referred to as midgets. Now it's a very offensive term within the dwarf community, sort of akin to the N-word for black people. And if we have time, I will get back to that, although I am amazed at how much time I'm chewing up here. Possible medical complications. Let me just sort of quickly run through this, because I'm not sure how relevant it is to get into great detail. Again, I'm going to stick with achondroplasia, which, in addition to being the most common type of dwarfism, probably has the fewest medical complications of any type of dwarfism. In babyhood, things can go wrong, and we certainly learned that with Becky. She was our second child, and I think we were making a pretty good adjustment to her dwarfism. And when she was 5 months old, she caught a very bad cold, RSV, and had to be rushed to Mass General. Now, we had already noticed that she snored like a truck driver and sort of arched her head back when she was sleeping as if she were trying to open up her air passages better. And in fact, we found out that that's exactly what she was doing. So after her RSV calmed down, we found out that she had to have a tracheotomy because her airways were just too tiny to give her the oxygen she needed to breathe. So for 2 years, we had that, supplemental oxygen, nurses running in and out of the house all the time. I mean, as you can imagine, it was a fairly difficult time in our lives. And as I suggested at the beginning, it's something that I used to talk about a lot more than I do today, but it's beginning to feel more and more like ancient history. This all ended a few months before her third birthday. Today she is 14 years old and, you know, perfectly healthy. Now, there's another medical complication that actually comes up much more often than what Becky went through and is scarier. And that is that the opening in the spinal column of somebody with dwarfism isn't quite big enough to accommodate the spinal cord. And the way this often manifests itself in kids is that the top of the brainstem gets pinched by the top of the spinal column, the area called the foramen magnum. And this can result in severe sleep apnea. Obviously, it can result in death. And the kids need to undergo a pretty important operation. And we were able to avoid that, fortunately. Equally fortunately, this is an operation that is now conducted usually without complication. One other childhood complication that is a little hard to get your arms around because it's somewhat controversial as to what, if anything, needs to be done about it, is all people with achondroplasia have mild hydrocephalus, water in the brain. The reason for this is that the opening at the base of the skull is a little bit smaller than it is with people who don't have achondroplasia. And so that results in some fluid being retained and the head being a little bit larger than it otherwise might be. Now, at one time, I think a lot of people got shunts for this mild hydrocephalus. And the problem with that is that once you have the shunt, you're stuck with it. There's no real way that they can undo it. And the medical emergency that Zach Roloff runs into in Little People Big World involves problems with his shunt. Today, it's better understood that a little hydrocephalus is normal and harmless, and so the shunting is much less common than it used to be. Now, as I said, the other time of life where people tend to get into some trouble is middle age and later. And this is where the spinal column problem manifests itself again. This time, usually in the lower back, where you end up with spinal stenosis because it's such a tight fit of the spinal column inside the spinal, the spinal cord inside the spinal column. And so you need surgery known as a laminectomy to open up that spinal column. People get tingling, numbness. You let it go too long, you lose the ability to walk. You go to these conferences, and even with laminectomies, a lot of people middle age and older are using scooters, they're using wheelchairs because the spinal stenosis problem has robbed them of their ability to walk, or at least to walk long distances. I had an opportunity to watch a surgeon at Johns Hopkins, Dr. Michael Ain, who is himself a dwarf, do a spinal fusion on a middle-aged dwarf man who was having a laminectomy. And that was, I don't spend a lot of time in operating rooms. That was quite a thing to observe. Dr. Huber suggested that I spend a moment, was there a question back there? Nope, okay. Just spend a moment on limb lengthening surgery. It's one of these subjects that seems to generate far more discussion than its actual incidence level would ever suggest. Very few people ever get limb lengthening surgery. But certainly there are a few. It's pretty negatively thought of within the community. I kind of take a moderate view. There are some very good doctors doing limb lengthening surgery. Again, when I was doing my book, I had a chance to spend a day with Dr. Dwar Haley, who is probably the world's leading limb lengthening surgeon. Followed him around at his clinic in Baltimore. It's pretty amazing. You can add a foot in height, and you can also, you know, add some length to the arms. The side effects, in some rare cases, can be infection, paralysis, even death. And I think that what many of us believe, and I pretty much share this view, is that you're running, these are tiny risks, but it's essentially cosmetic surgery. So why would you do that? But you know, there were people who take another view. My main objection is that the surgery, I'll get right back to you, okay. Is that the surgery works best when it's done on young teenagers. Dr. Paley's finding that it works even better when you start them off as young as 8. So I guess my biggest problem with limb lengthening surgery is that almost by definition, there can't really be informed consent because kids want to look like their friends. And if you can get them through high school and get them off to college, all of a sudden the idea of going through all of this horrible, painful surgery so they can look sort of like everybody else, but not quite, you know, the need for that kind of fades away. Yes?
I was just wondering if it was discouraged amongst the dwarf community to, like, get limb lengthening, if, like,
yes.
Looked down upon it.
Is it looked down upon within the community? Yeah, it really is. It really is. A friend of mine who's a past president of Little People of America also told me that she knew of no one who'd ever gotten involved in LPA and then who went off and had limb lengthening surgery. So a lot of it is an early introduction to the idea that people with dwarfism lead perfectly productive, happy lives and don't need to go through that. And if they're introduced to that, the idea of giving up 3 summers of your life for this surgery just starts to fade away. Yes, hold it here.
Is the surgery still done the same way where they put the pins into your leg and they only separate by like a quarter of an inch or even smaller?
Yeah, that's exactly right. That hasn't changed. They break the bones, they stick in these pins, you've got these frames around you, and they separate the bone a little bit and let everything heal. It's a fairly gruesome procedure. It's amazing it works as well as it does, frankly. Now, if that's cosmetic surgery, that doesn't mean that there might not be a variant of it that helps function. And in fact, Becky's orthopedist has suggested that we consider, and she's almost at the age where we have to make this decision, and she doesn't like the idea of surgery, so I don't know what the answer's going to be. But he's come to like the idea of doing an operation where you correct the elbow deformity that comes with achondroplasia so that you can fully straighten out your arm. And at the same time that you're doing it, you do this procedure that you're talking about with the bone breaking and the fixators and all that, and add about an inch to the length of the arms. Between the two procedures, you end up, it's as though you were adding 3 inches to your reach. And in terms of especially personal hygiene, that can be a fairly valuable addition. And it is something that we're going to talk about with Becky. But even Dr. Paley will tell you that the arm part of the limb lengthening surgery is far less difficult than the leg part. So right there, we've skipped, even if Becky decides to go ahead and do this, we've skipped by far the most difficult part of the procedure and just gone to the sort of the easy part. Yes?
You were talking about people who are just shorter due to lack of growth hormone.
Yes.
And they have synthetic hormones and then they grow. Has it ever been attempted to dwarf synthetic growth hormone? And if so, what were the results?
Have they ever given synthetic growth hormone to people with achondroplasia? Yes. They've done it. It does nothing. I think that there was some finding that the kids might do their what growing they're going to do, they end up doing it earlier than they otherwise would, but that the final height is not affected. It just wouldn't do anything. Yes.
You've mentioned the dwarf community.
Yes.
Would you say it's the same type of, I guess, relationship that the deaf community has?
Good question. I have not observed the deaf community, obviously, in the kind of detail that I have the dwarf community. But, in doing my research and my reading and sort of considering the more politically active elements of the deaf community, I would say that there are some key differences. The dwarf community seems to be more, how would I put this, more conservative, more mainstream, more interested in being mainstream than the deaf community. And as opposed as many people are to the idea of limb lengthening surgery, I have certainly never heard anyone refer to it as genocide, as some deaf activists refer to the cochlear implants that are sometimes done to help them hear. I also think that if you talk to anybody within the dwarf community about the possibility of a real genetic cure, for instance, something that would accomplish what limb lengthening surgery does, only better and without the side effects, I think everyone understands that people would do that. I don't think you hear the kind of militancy that is sometimes associated with activism from the deaf community. And like I said, I haven't studied the deaf community that closely. I don't know whether that attitude is really widespread or just the view of a few of the more militant people, but that's my take on it. I've already mentioned that the word midget has fallen into disfavor. Let me explain that a little more, and then I'm going to see if we can go right to a few more questions because I've got like 7 pages here and I'm only halfway through it. So let me talk about the M word a little bit. Dwarf is a word with a long and reasonably noble history. It's a 7th century word of Germanic origins, I think. Midget was coined only in like the mid-1860s. It's often thought to have been coined by P.T. Barnum. That's another myth that I found not to be true in the course of doing my research. In fact, it looks like if it was coined by anyone, it was coined by Harriet Beecher Stowe in one of her novels of that era. It seems to be derived from the word midge, which is a small, insignificant bug, which may start to get at the reason why it's such an unpopular term. And in the latter part of the 19th century, it came to be used especially to describe people with proportionate types of dwarfism who were put on public display. It's very much a circus and sideshow term. Now, to go back to Barnum for a moment, the two most famous dwarfs in history worked for Barnum. Charles Stratton and Lavinia Warren, better known as General and Mrs. Tom Thumb. Now, they were proportionate. If anyone were to fit the definition of midget, it would be Charles and Lavinia. And yet, in Barnum's autobiography, he never uses the word midget to describe them. Invariably, he uses the word dwarf. And why? Well, he wrote his autobiography in the 1850s, and the word hadn't been coined yet. Now, Barnum and others used it later, in the late 1800s. That's when Barnum got into the circus business. People often think of Barnum's circus as the main part of his life. Actually, it was just something he did toward the end of his life. Charles Stratton had already passed away by that point. And midget was thought to be a more prestigious term than dwarf. And the reason for that is that in the circus and the sideshows, the proportionate dwarfs got better parts. They got to be dressed up in nice clothes and paraded around that way, whereas the disproportionate folks tend to be cast more as the freaks. So midget was actually kind of a better term in that era. As late as 1959, when the actor Billy Barty put out a call for people with dwarfism to gather, I think that first gathering was in Reno, and I should remember that, but I don't. It was under the banner of Midgets of America. And at their very first gathering, they met and said, okay, what's the real name of the organization going to be? And the reason that they didn't think that Midgets of America worked was because, well, too many of us aren't midgets, we're dwarfs. It wasn't that midget was thought to be offensive. So they actually tried out Midgets and Dwarfs of America before deciding on Little People of America. Now, from the 60s on, I think the more politically aware people within the community decided they didn't like midget. It's too wrapped up in the idea of a person put on public display. So little person became more popular, although a lot of people, I'll tell you, think it's too euphemistic and cutesy. There is a dwarf artist I know, amazing woman, civil rights worker in the 60s. She's always said she will not join the organization until it changes its name because she just hates little people. Dwarf was kind of embraced as better, but you know, really, the whole labeling thing gets to be problematic. I mean, you know, the best thing you can call my daughter is Becca. She doesn't like Rebecca. But, you know, I mean, labels are useful for some things, I suppose, but you really wonder why labeling is necessary to that extent. And I could keep right on going, but I always tell my students, you know, I've just got so much. You've got 3 hours, right? And they never seem to have 3 hours. But at this point, I'm going to break it off to see if we can just give the rest of our time together to questions and comments. Yes, back here. Well, you know, there are some things that people with achondroplasia should not do. They shouldn't do a lot of running. People can run around, you know. But you shouldn't do a lot of running because it's too much pressure on the spine. You know, tackle football is a problem, obviously. Swimming is great. Biking is great. My daughter loves to swim. She does it all the time. There is also an organization called the Dwarf Athletic Association of America that stages competitions and all kinds of things where people with dwarfism are able to compete on a more or less equal basis against each other, because obviously if you have a softball game, the people with dwarfism are at some disadvantage. That said, Dr. Michael Ain, the surgeon, the orthopedic surgeon with achondroplasia, who I mentioned a little while ago, was the backup second baseman on the baseball team at Brown on his merits. He was not a token. So you do see that from time to time. It's not unheard of. I saw another hand.
How tall is he?
Yes.
How tall is he?
He's, what is he, 4'2", I think? 4'3"? He was the backup second baseman at Brown. I have no idea how good a baseball team Brown had. Maybe it wasn't very good. Yes?
You were saying that they had to be like 4'10" or shorter, but you said there's dwarfs that are taller than that. How tall can a woman with dwarfism be?
Somebody with achondroplasia, it would be almost unheard of for them to be over 4'4", 4'5". That would be way at the extreme end. But remember, there are many different types of dwarfism. Robert Reich has a type of dwarfism called, I forget what it's called, metatropic epiphyseal something or other. You know, I once heard him say, I'm not a dwarf, I have a medical condition. Yeah, you know, it's a dwarfism condition, Professor Reich. But that condition results in a somewhat taller height. He's like 4'10", 4'11". Steve Delano, SED. There are different types of SED. And there are folks that range from 2'10". It's a former administrator of LPA who has SED. She's 2'10". You worry about, you know, stepping on her, because if you're not paying attention, she's way down here, all the way up to 5'1" or 2". There's a very rare condition known as primordial dwarfism. Have any of you ever heard of primordial dwarfism? I see a few hands. Sometimes, you know, it's a really subset of a subset where the kids have almost a, and I say kids because unfortunately there's very little record of any of them living much beyond their teens, even though nobody's quite sure why. Maybe this current generation will do better because they're being watched more closely medically. But they almost have bird-like features to the face, and they're about 2 feet tall. It's remarkable. And when they're young, they're physically quite robust. And I mean, you see them doing flips. I mean, it's just an amazing condition. They seem to have mild cognitive disability, but nobody's sure. It's kind of a mysterious condition. It's very, very, very rare. And the doctor is Judith Hall, who has devoted a good part of her career to studying primordial dwarfism, has said she literally doesn't know whether the kids seem to be cognitively impaired and die young because that's really part of the condition, or simply because they've never had the proper care. And so you may find that 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 becomes kind of a different situation as time goes on. Yes, over here. Well, the reason they got the shunts is because of this hydrocephalus condition with the kids. And as I said, it is beginning to appear that far more shunts have been put in than were necessary. There's mild hydrocephalus, it's not going to get any worse, you don't need the shunt. This isn't true with everybody, but it's certainly true with some of them. And I do know that there are some parents out there who did not get their kids into the hands of a good dwarfism specialist early on. And as a result, these kids are walking around today with shunts when they don't really need them. And my understanding is that once the shunt's put in, that's it. It can't come out. So because there are sometimes complications with shunts, this is seen as being kind of an unfortunate mistake in some cases, although in some cases it's necessary.
But for those who need them, why don't you need
them? Well, probably because this opening in the base of the skull, which is smaller than normal in people with achondroplasia, in some cases it would be, you know, to use the scientific term, way smaller than normal. And so maybe that becomes a real problem, and they definitely do need the shunt. If there were gradations to everything, just as some people with achondroplasia are 3'10 and some people are 4'2, some have a slightly smaller opening than normal, and some people have a much smaller opening than normal. Yes, right here.
Sort of a follow-up along the same lines with the permanent magma problem. Is that related? Is that the same? Like, if somebody who has the pinching brain, they're going to have more likely hydrocephalus and media shunts, and if you fix the permanent magma, make bigger, you guys are solve both problems. You know, are they, if you have one of those issues, are you more likely to have the other?
People have spent a lot of time thinking about that. And the answer is there doesn't seem to be any correlation of, well, if you have this, you're more likely to have that. In fact, you might think that people on the taller side of achondroplasia might be less likely to develop some of these other problems because they must have a milder achondroplasia condition. That doesn't seem to be the case. It seems that these things are completely unrelated to one another. Now, that said, Becky had the small airways that required the tracheotomy, and that's an unusual complication. So we would be sitting back and saying, gee, does this mean she's going to run into other problems? In fact, we have been told that her spinal cord is sitting inside her spinal column a little more tightly than is usually the case at her age. So it's possible that she would need to have a laminectomy at an earlier age than other people. And that might lead you to say, well, gee, if you have one complication, does it mean that you're more likely to have other complications? So, you know, on the anecdotal evidence of a sample size of one, we're saying, well, gee, maybe that's the case. But, you know, people have really wondered about these correlations, and they haven't found any.
We have time just for one more question.
Like I said, I could go for 3 hours, but you probably have somewhere to go. Yes?
Is there any other people in your family besides your children that have dwarfism?
No. There are not. And as I suggested, dwarfism is a dominant condition. So even my wife and I are no more likely to have more kids with achondroplasia than any other couple. Of course, at our age, we're pretty unlikely to have any more kids at all, but that's another matter. Now, if you look at Matt Roloff with diastrophic dysplasia, which is a recessive condition, well, this is a very interesting situation. both of his parents had one gene for diastrophic dysplasia without knowing it. They are carriers, and they got married and had kids. And, you know, both Matt and his brother Sam have diastrophic dysplasia, even though both of their parents are average size, because they are carriers of the gene. It's almost unheard of for two average-sized parents to have more than one kid with achondroplasia, because it's the same 1 in 25,000 crapshoot every time. Whereas Matt Roloff's parents both carry the recessive gene, it's I guess it's a 50% chance every time they have kids. I'm not too good at math unless it's earned on average, but that's what I think it is.
And we have to turn it back to Lindsay in terms of her time. Okay.
Oh, thank you very much for coming with us today. This is a sweatshirt from the clinic.
Oh, cool. Thank you very much. Well, what size is it?
This is a large.
A large? Perfect. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.